Hi, I'm Dr. Honos-Webb, and I'm going to be talking today about the 6 super skills to build executive functioning. And executive functioning, we often think of the diagnosis ADHD, but it can apply to many other things with autism or a traumatic brain injury. Actually, the executive functioning doesn't actually fully develop until the age of 25. So for anyone under that age, many of these skills are going to be helpful and probably for most adults anyways, to think of it in terms of mind building. Even if you don't have an executive dysfunction or a diagnosis, I really like to encourage this idea of, just as bodybuilders go to the gym to get healthier and to prevent and protect their health, so can we do that with our own mental health. We can have this ideal of getting stronger and stronger. And these 6 super skills are going to be the components of mind building. So just to list them first, the first one is finding gifts. The second one is setting goals. The third one is chunking goals into smaller stepping stones. And then comes managing mood and boosting motivation. And then finally, finding focus. So when we start with finding gifts, that one tends to be the place to start, and a lot of times the hardest for people. And that can be as simple as asking people to list their 3 biggest strengths and asking people to invite other people to share with them what they see as their biggest strengths. Another thing can be, I often invite my clients to keep a running, whether it's a Word document or a Google Doc or on your phone, a list of every time you feel appreciated, from the great things to even the small things. And that can be something that you can turn to remind yourself of your strengths. And why this is important is because one thing we have found is that motivation is going to be directly related to finding strengths. So to give you an example, one study showed that for kids who refuse to do a specific problem, if a teacher were to say, "When's the last time you had success solving a problem like this?" that they would all of a sudden have the motivation, because they had the confidence to move forward, but they just needed to remember one other time that they had a past success with a similar project. And so that gives us one other tool that we can talk about for how do you find your gifts, is listing your past successes. And so what are the biggest successes you've had? What are just some of the small successes you've had? And again, kind of create a ongoing list of that you can review to boost that confidence. And for the second super skill of setting goals, one of the most important things to think about is, this is maps right on to planning. And that's one of the executive functions that can be missing is, long-term planning. We just live in the moment. We ask ourselves, what do I feel like doing right now, instead of asking, what's my purpose in this moment? And so you can see how that could get us in trouble. So as you set goals or encourage other people to set goals, you could think of, what's your goal for today? What's your goal for this week? What's your goal for this month? What's your goal for the next year? What's your goal for the next 5 years? And so you can see how you could carry that out. And also in terms of thinking about those goals, another way, if someone is struggling with this, is to ask them to have this kind of conversation with their future self. And depending on how old they are, it could be, think of yourself a year from now. What would your future self want to say to you about what you should be doing now or what you shouldn't be doing now? And so those goals might be to stop doing harmful activities. They could be to start doing helpful activities, to start an exercise program. And those goals can be in the arena of, let's say, work or school. It can be in the health arena. It can be in the social arena. Do you want to build a greater professional network? Do you want to have more friends that you can meet and talk about positive things, instead of just kind of using it as a, to complain about what's not working? And so as you think about all these different arenas, even bucket list goals can be very important. Sometimes as you have a goal to, go travel to another country, you do have to break that goal down into smaller pieces, and it can help you to build skills and to build motivation that transfers to lots of other areas of your life. And so in the chunking, which is the third super skill, where you break a goal down into small, manageable steps, it can be as simple as a lot of people with executive dysfunction are really challenged with organization, and they think it has to be this major big project, and they have so much resistance to it because it feels like it's overwhelming. And so chunking could be really as simple as, I sometimes ask clients to imagine, you know, as the waves are lapping onto a beach, it's just a repetitive activity, you know, that you just throughout the day, you take a minute here to straighten something up. You take another minute here to put some order to some things around you. And you could even create a list of 2-minute actions. And it could be, you know, wipe off the kitchen sink, take out the bathroom garbage, you know, whatever those things are, clean my desktop for 2 minutes on your computer. And coming up with some 2-minute actions and taking that. And it really takes this overwhelming idea of getting organized and brings it down to something very simple to do, 2-minute things, repetitive actions, small actions would be an example of chunking. And then in terms of boosting motivation, one of the things that can be really helpful is we often focus on what we don't want to do. Oh man, I really don't want to do that email that makes me have to think about, you know, 10 different things. But in terms of motivation, you might ask yourself instead, how hard is this going to be? Is how good will I feel when I'm done with that? And it also brings up this idea in terms of motivation that sometimes the thing called eat the frog is do the hardest thing first. And if you can just think about that hard thing and think about how good you'll feel when it's over, and then you get that hard thing out of the way, the motivation for the things that come after may be easier because they're not as hard as that first thing that you already completed. There's some things you can say to yourself to boost motivation. And some of those things are, I can do hard things. A lot of the tools around boosting motivation have to do with, you know, building your confidence and also thinking about the benefits of getting it over, thinking about the consequences of not getting it done. You know, what's going to happen to me if I don't get it done? And so it's this kind of simple process of thinking about your relationship to that resistance. And part of the solution is just to say, hey, you know, just as I talked about with mind builders, I can do hard things. And that when we think about mind building, as you can boost your motivation, that can become a source of a gift that you have, that you can build that motivation and be a person who doesn't shrink away from hard things and kind of develop a relationship with that resistance. And you can even ask yourself, can I overcome resistance today? And then as we move on to managing mood, which is the fifth super skill, one of the simplest perspectives, one of the simplest tools for managing mood can be taking a much broader perspective. So often moods, whether it be, you know, feeling sad or mad or anxious or feeling guilty, can be related to narrowing in on something that happened. Why did I say that thing when I saw my friend in the store? That, you know, what is she thinking? I bet you she's thinking all these things about me. And so taking a broader perspective can be, you know, looking, you know, imagine the 30,000 feet from the sky as you look past at your, as you look back at your day, instead of thinking about the things that went wrong, actively asking yourself, you know, what did I get appreciated today? What was the time I felt happy today? What's something I'm excited about? What's something that I feel grateful for? What makes me feel secure? And so you're kind of actively what I like to call turning the bus around, which means you're actively looking for some positives in your day and this much broader perspective. So it's the difference between kind of taking a microscope and examining things you didn't feel good about, but taking this broader perspective and actually asking yourself some questions. And when you ask yourself those questions, like what made me happy, you know, what do I feel grateful for? You're actually not only pulling for the positive emotions, but you're soothing the negative emotions. And so one other tool that you can use is to think about, you know, a couple questions and whichever one comes the easiest for you to answer. When was the time I felt the most appreciated? Or what was my happiest memory, you know, in the recent past? Or, and having like a memory and or a very specific time where you felt appreciated, and that you, just as we sometimes ruminate about the negative things that happen, this is the opposite of that. I'm going to ask you to ruminate about the positive things. And if you're a visual thinker and you can visualize things, imagine the happy memories, you put them on a huge screen. And then the more negative memories, unless it's, you know, something you need to focus on to do some problem solving about, you want to kind of minimize those screens, to shrink them down. And you can have control over how much you weigh the positive memories and the negative memories. And, you know, there's some other things that you can do is to ask yourself about some challenges you've overcome and what are those personal qualities in yourself. And what you'll see here is you'll notice there's a connection between some of the super skills that when we looked at the finding gifts, that's going to be very important to managing our mood. And so, for example, someone, you know, gave you a compliment that, you know, you're a very funny and fun person. And that can be something that you can, instead of searching back for anxiety makes us think, did I mess that up? Did I do that wrong? You could look back across, you know, your day and say, was there a time when I was fun and funny? Did I make someone laugh? Did I someone else make me laugh? So again, it's very much about selective attention here. And then the last super skill of finding focus, this is all research based. There's so much research about what increases attention and what decreases attention. So, you know, the number one is exercise. And the amount of exercise it takes to boost your attention is not the same thing as how much it takes to get in shape. And they found, you know, one study showed that bouncing a ball against the wall for 10 minutes actually increased people's attention span. Taking a short walk can do it. And one study even showed that the people who were fidgeting, that fidgeting, that small amount of physical activity seemed to have a positive effect on their attention. And so in addition to increasing in exercise, time in nature has been found to be a very reliable way of boosting attention. And they did studies where, you know, people who went for a walk in a natural setting, it boosted their attention more than people who didn't go for a walk. And then they also found in one study that doing something that wasn't in nature, like playing basketball, boosted attention because it was exercise, but that something about being in nature actually gave even a bigger boost to attention. So nature is important. Some other things important for boosting attention, and some of these are going to be pretty obvious, but I think it's just good to go through the reminders. And so one of those is going to be sleep. In fact, sleep is fundamental to pretty much everything we've talked about, and such that sleep, it boosts your attention and it improves your mood. And it's really related to all of the super skills. And then you can see that probably closely connected to getting sleep is going to be limiting technology. Too much technology, particularly right before bed, can interfere with sleep. And as you can imagine, in terms of focus, just the general idea of limiting technology, that having, you know, too many technology distractions is going to be something that interferes with attention, that distracts attention. And I think everyone can kind of relate to that. And it could even be something as simple as, I know some of you will be, you know, working on your computer and you'll have about 10 to 15 different tabs up, and each one of those is a pull on your attention. And so one little experiment you can make is, what would it be like to work with only one tab up? And it's kind of exactly what we're talking about when what we mean by focus, that we're paying attention to one thing at a time. It's pretty well documented that multitasking is a myth, that we're not very good at it, that when we multitask, not only are we going to work slower, but we're going to make more mistakes. And that, and then in fact, we're usually not doing two things at the same time. It's more likely to be what's called switch tasking, which means you're going back and forth between one and the other. And that's not efficient. It doesn't help with focus, and you're going to be more likely to make mistakes. So this gives you kind of a quick run through of the six super skills. And I hope that, you know, that they're memorable enough that in any moment, you know, when you're struggling with paying attention, or you're struggling with flexible thinking and you feel really stuck, or you're struggling with impulsiveness, which can come from, you know, lack of motivation to do what you're supposed to do, or being in a bad mood. You know, this can all relate to addictions. You know, we talked about executive functioning as being related to ADHD and autism, but I would say that executive functioning is both a cause and a consequence of addictions. That an addiction is about using a substance to solve a problem rather than using your executive functioning to solve a problem. It can also be about, many people can use substances, but they don't abuse them or they don't become dependent on them. And so it is these executive functions of setting a goal, of limiting your intake, that if you feel confident in yourself, you're not using substances to give you some confidence, or you're not using substances to try to feel motivated. And so again, as you think about how interconnected all of the, you know, executive functioning is, which means just being the boss of your brain, that these six super skills will each help and enhance each other, boost your executive functioning. And really the whole point of this is to set a goal and to get a goal, to focus on completion. These are the things most of us want for ourselves and for our kids and for our family and friends. And so this is just a six quick ways, and I threw out a bunch of different examples and tools that hopefully you can just start to use right now. And if you like this approach, in the fall, I have a book coming out, The Six Super Skills to Build Executive Functioning for Teens. And so that's coming out in fall. You can look for that. You can learn a lot more at my website, addisagift.com. addisagift.com. And there you'll find some of the online programs I have. And one that might be of interest for parents is, how can you as a parent, or even if you work a manager in the workplace, how can you give these six super skills to someone else? It's a great thing to learn all the tools and, you know, for example, to list all the times you felt appreciated, but how do you help another person to build these six super skills? What I call mind building. And so if you take a look at my website, you'll learn more about my book that's coming out, some of my previous books. I've written six other books on ADHD and depression and executive functioning. And so when you have a chance to check that out, you'll find a lot more resources if you're interested in learning more. Okay, it's been a lot of fun to participate in the summit. Take care.